There are a handful of reasons we don't see old airframes upgraded with new engines more often. However, such a practice has been done before on several occasions. So, for today's video, let's look at a few cases where re-engining has taken place, but also look at why it doesn't really happen these days. And so first, let's look at three interesting examples of old airframes and new engines. The Douglas DC-8 had an engine upgrade program in the 1980s which saw the DC-8 61, 62 and 63 variants swap their old JT3D engines for more efficient CFM56 power plants. These re-engined aircraft were re-designated as DC-8 71, 72 and 73 respectively. Collectively, these aircraft were called Super 70s and were about 70% quieter than the Super 60 series. As noted by AirlineRatings.com, a total of 110 DC-8s were converted when the program wound down in 1986. Then there's the Boeing 727. In the late 1980s, a firm by the name of Valson Partners launched a program to remove the two fuselage-mounted GT8D engines from the 727-200 and replace them with newer, higher bypass ratio JT8D-200 series engines fitted within new nacelles. The existing JT8D center engine would then be equipped with a special internal nozzle within a new acoustically treated tailpipe. The re-engined 727-200RE was quieter and more efficient. Unfortunately, there was limited interest in the upgrade, which only saw 23 conversions. Due to Valson's limited success, a California-based nacelle manufacturer known as Roar had launched the Super 27 Boeing 727 re-engining program in 1996. Unfortunately, it doesn't appear that Roar had much more success than Valson, likely due to the higher appeal of brand new aircraft coming from Airbus and Boeing. This final example comes from the military side of aviation, the US Air Force's KC-135 Stratotankers. As we noted in a previous long-haul video, these aircraft entered military service as early as 1957 and even predate the Boeing 707. Based on the Boeing 367-80 prototype, the KC-135 has a narrower and shorter fuselage than the 707. KC-135s were originally fitted with Pratt & Whitney J57 engines. Then, in the 1980s, the first modification program retrofitted 157 tankers with Pratt & Whitney JT3D turbofan engines sourced from retired 707s. This retrofit took place in the 1970s and 80s. An old letter to the Secretary of the Air Force from the U.S. General Accounting Office recalls the specifics, saying, "In September 1981, the Air Logistics Center awarded Boeing Military Airplane Company a firm fixed-price contract of about $70 million for purchase of 18 used 707 aircraft and 21 spare engines, refurbishing the engines and modifying the KC-135 aircraft, including the engine replacement. Boeing subcontracted with Transworld Airlines to refurbish the 72 engines removed from 707 aircraft. More JT3D engines from 707s would be acquired in the following years. With the newer engines, these aircraft were now equipped with thrust reversers for aborted takeoffs and shorter landing rollouts. The KC-135s didn't just get JT3D engines, however. Other KC-135s would be fitted with CFM56 engines. The first of these re-engined aircraft, designated KC-135R, was delivered in 1984. A 1984 paper from the U.S. Congressional Budget Office states that the CFM56 re-engining program allowed the KC-135R tankers to land at more airfields. The paper adds, "Other features unique to this re-engining program include strengthened main landing gear, auxiliary power units for quick start of all electrical systems, and some new instrument and control systems." The table shown here gives us a straightforward comparison of how KC-135s were re-engined and updated with the two types of engines, including additional work performed for modernization. In case it sounds familiar, variants of the CFM International CFM56 family, US military designation F108, have been used to power numerous commercial passenger aircraft. This long list includes 737s from the Classic and NG series, as well as A320 family aircraft, from the A318 through to the A321. CFM56 engines have also powered Airbus A340-200s and Dash-300s. It would appear that the US Air Force was quite pleased with the re-engining of KC-135s with the CFM56, so much so that in 2000 it released funding to purchase 36 additional CFM56-2 engines to re-engine 4 KC-135 tanker and 5 RC-135 reconnaissance aircraft. Within a 24-year-old press statement from the engine maker, the director of CFM's military engine program stated, "KC-135 re-engining has been one of the most successful modernization programs in U.S. Air Force history, and this latest order is yet another U.S. Air Force endorsement of what we've been able to accomplish." And with these three case studies in mind, it's clear that re-engining old airframes is possible. So why is it not more common? Well, there are a few reasons. Firstly, the size of newer engines may simply not be suitable for the old airframe. This is best demonstrated by everything that has happened with the 737 MAX. We know that even this newest generation of 737 with its low-to-the-ground legacy airframe had issues fitting newer, more efficient, and larger engines under its wings. But with a desire to retain commonality with previous generations, Boeing's MAX generation had to have similar dimensions to those older jets. And so, to accommodate the larger engines that would still ensure proper ground clearance, these engines were attached to the wings higher and further forward. While Boeing managed to pull this off, the larger, heavier, and more powerful engines led to changes in the aircraft's handling, forcing the company to include software to compensate for the unsafe aircraft behavior. The software fix was known as MCAS, and most of you already know the tragic result of this system, as it reacted to erroneous inputs, causing 2 fatal crashes. And so, even though Boeing was fitting brand new engines to brand new aircraft, it shows the challenges of doing so with an old airframe design. If you want to retain the old structure or the older design, the newer engines could have an impact on aircraft handling and physics. But if the technical and physical challenges can be overcome to accommodate a new engine, the next hurdle will be cost, the cost of research and development, and the cost to recertify the aircraft. Additionally, beyond the cost of new engines, airframes will likely need additional modification work to fit those newer power plants. Finding companies, whether they be engine makers or airlines, to invest in this costly work could be difficult. With very little to gain, we probably wouldn't see plane makers investing in such programs. But finally, airframe age and remaining lifespan should be considered. The Air Force's KC-135s were suitable for engine upgrades as they don't fly nearly as much as commercial aircraft. Douglas DC-8s that were upgraded were often passenger jets that became freighters, flying less frequently after getting those newer engines. For passenger jets, those daily or almost daily pressurization and depressurization cycles take a toll on the airframe over time. Thus, depending on the age and operational history of older aircraft, it simply won't be worth it to upgrade them with newer engines amid all the costs. With all of these factors considered, it makes sense that upgrading old airframes with new engines is seldom undertaken. Nonetheless, if you could re-engine any commercial aircraft with new engines, which aircraft would you pick? And which engines would you choose for it? Let us know by leaving a comment. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.